doesn't really matter who I bring along with me right now, because I'm not really going to be venturing forward to take out Kucha. Okay, airship navigation. Thanks for telling me about this again. We have a new airship. Let's go take a look at the inside of it. Kucha destroyed what remained, at least, of Terra. And, while showing off his new power, his newfound power, the ability to trance, and with that, he has become vastly more powerful than anything we have faced before. He was already probably a pretty powerful fellow to begin with, although how much of an evidence of that there really was, I don't really know. But he definitely had power before, and well, he's got more now. We didn't really have a chance to ever fight him at all until that fight after Garland. Until we fought Garland, after we fought Garland, we never really had a direct encounter with him, a direct physical confrontation. They always kind of just sort of, by reputation alone, sort of pushed the idea that he was an all-powerful badass. But wasn't until then. But he didn't really demonstrate any supreme power there. Then he trances and becomes vastly stronger, and now he's destroy the world. He's going to destroy ours. Now, even though he has become this ultimate power, get the impression that that didn't solve the problem of his limited lifespan. It seems as though his lifespan is sort of like hard-coded in his DNA, so that he wouldn't be able to live forever. He was a flawed creation. And it was built intentionally flawed, not... He was created with the intention, with this flaw, so he'd be kept on a short leash. His ambition doesn't have time to grow too large if he simply won't live long enough to act on it. So he's 24 years old, but he's... I don't know how soon he will die, but the impression is given that it's definitely sooner rather than later. Okay, new stuff. I do not have enough gold to really buy a lot of shit. Running around and seeing these black mages and the genomes interacting with each other is a little bit weird, they're both in a lot of ways very similar. They're both created some purpose, and they were created with the intention of them not having any kind of souls. And it's perhaps not true, listen to the way that this one talks, that it is not entirely soulless. It's perhaps underdeveloped, kind of blank slate kind of thing. Like a child who never had any opportunity to learn and develop or anything like that. But the black mages perhaps have had a little bit longer, a little bit more time to acclimate to their newfound freedom and their own thought and all that kind of stuff. So you're seeing a slightly different situation between them. They're both, in a lot of ways, just children. Black mages aren't that well developed, but they are a little bit further along the line than the genomes. So it's kind of like just a weird comparison to make between them. The black mages are obviously going to be a big help in helping the genomes get across and develop on their own, but in their own people. But they're not, they're being helped by sort of like almost like a blind leading the blind kind of thing. Look at this. All this new stuff. I think I have all of these. I guess there's nothing up here. There's a synth shop up there, and they've got some good looking stuff, some good stuff that I don't have yet. But, they're trying to name, one of the genomes. Trying to name it with a number. Of course, both Kuja and Zidan, and hell, even Garland, were manufactured life forms. They weren't natural in any way, and they may have been modeled after the template that is the people of Terra. But that doesn't mean that they're any different, really, than the mages. Of course, they have had a much longer period of time in order to sort of come into their own and develop their own personality. So I would imagine maybe at one point Garland was very much like the soulless creatures that we had seen in that village. And of course there is a danger to allowing a construct like him to exist completely on his own and developing in his own rate and to his own purposes or anything like that. It's, I guess maybe the people of Terra didn't have any other option. They need somebody to stay alive, somebody to stay awake, and someone to prepare prepare Gaia for the eventual consumption by Terra. But even after all that time, he seems to have remained loyal to his own cause, even though he seems like he was operating with some measure of his own will there in creating Kuja and creating Zidan, something which doesn't seem like was part of the initial plan. Notice the game has now gone and covered the entire world with fog. Now, we saw fog here before. Now, the highlands, I guess, are still not covered in it because this is where people lived before and the fog was bad. But down here, the fog has returned. And it's not just, although it does, oh well, there's fog here though. Nope, there's not. Get down here and it disappears. It's not just everywhere we have seen it before though. Fog has gone and covered the entire planet. Now, it was mentioned to us before that we did not kill the Ifritu. It was, we seem to have stopped its depositing of the souls of Gaia back into the surface, but it didn't stop them from, stop the tree from doing what it was doing, and it was preventing the souls from returning. It's kind of like the same kind of situation we have seen in Final Fantasy VII, where the Mako, or the spirit energy, whatever it was the lifeblood of the planet. Somebody would die, their soul would turn into the spirit energy and return to the planet. And then that would allow the planet to live on, and their wisdom and their life and all that kind of stuff would return to the planet and allow it to grow stronger and be in sustenance. And then that spirit energy would reform back on the planet as another person or another animal or a tree or whatever. And of course, in that game, a big part of the storyline was the abstraction of this energy and its use as an energy source, as a fuel source. Sort of the same thing is happening here, although the result of that energy, which is the fog or the mist, is largely just incidental. The tree, which, let's go get a good look at it here before I sign off. The tree was blocking the return of the souls of the people of Gaia returning to the planet. But instead of just burning it off and all that kind of stuff, it was just sort of dumping it back out onto the surface. And it was happening through the roots that we have stumbled across all over the map, all over the world map, the overworld. It didn't store them up or anything like that. It just prevented, it just absorbed them from returning to the planet and then just spewed them back out. And all of this soul energy all over the world tended to coalesce and turn into monsters. I mean, those souls had to turn into something. They couldn't, I guess, staying in the mist form was sort of an unnatural state for them. So they turned into just these horrendous monsters, and they were a big threat to everybody who was still alive in the world. I'm not entirely sure how long ago that happened. I guess if I look deeper into the lore of the game, maybe we'll find out when that happened. But it seems to have happened at some point within the recorded history of this world. Stopping the tree, we didn't really stop the tree. All we did was stop it from depositing the souls back out of the planet. And you know, it was probably just sort of building those souls up. And they were being absorbed into it. And then once Kuja returned to this world, he unleashed them again. And there was so many built up that it spewed all across the planet. And they're everywhere now. That fog is, the mist is everywhere. So, I don't know. People are probably freaking out. And there's seemingly no escape from it. But here we are. I'm going to sign off now. Next episode, I'll figure out whether I'm going to go take a run at Kuja or I'm going to do